Yes, I'm not sure what happened to his side of things. Let me know if you can see me or hear me. Looks like we're good on YouTube. Sorry for that break in service, but there's always something with this live streaming thing. It says we're overloading almost every stream. It's pretty annoying. Let me know. Give me like a 2-2. Oh, you said everything's cool? Okay, cool. All right, I didn't hear back from him, so let me keep Skype open just in case. So we lost Curtis King, but it's all good. So if you don't know, if you didn't know, these past 2 weeks we had two different events in Anaheim, California. We were in Love and Laughter Studios. Curtis King threw his music producer power seminar October 6th. And I had the music producer mastermind meeting October 13th, and we went over a lot of businessy stuff for producers. And one of the main things that came up was marketing strategies. Oh, he says he's back. Okay. Oh, he had an internet blackout in his area. Hopefully, that's not promotion for Call of Duty Blackout. Who has Call of Duty Black Ops? Did y'all buy it? And actually, I'm going to bring this topic back. So let me know if you bought Black Ops, because I did. I want to know your opinion. I think I found what I was looking for. Just weird. Wasn't the same, I think. Yeah, everything on the front page of busyworksbeats.com, excuse me, is a full course. Choking on powder, sorry. So if you see like music theory or let's say how to make bass lines, it's a whole course on how to make bass lines. And then like the next picture will be songwriting secrets. It's a whole course on songwriting secrets. I don't have the 1,000 videos. In the search thing, like I used to at busyworksbeats.com, because it was too messy, it wasn't organized, and it wasn't focused. So the premium is way different. It's all new. Ilasita is here. I just saw you pop in. What up, girl? Sounds from Mars. Noah's here. I don't think I said what's up. Classy, what's up? All right, let me try and get him back on Skype. It's gonna take a little time because I gotta deactivate my webcam on here. So give me 2 seconds, people. Do this. All right. Let me call him up. Remix that. Yeah, man. Okay, there we go.
My apologies. We're dealing with a blackout in the area right now. Just got a text message about
Oh, you good. Would Trump send you a federal text message?
it. He
The
said
internet? I'm here.
you're giving out too much info. He said you're giving out too much info. He said cut it out.
Man, have you seen that political? Like every website was putting up register to vote. Did y'all see that? Did you notice that? Like
No,
YouTube had it, Google had it, Twitter had it. I'm like, I've never seen all the websites say register to vote before.
Oh yeah, they. Because I mean, the websites make sense because of that whole net neutrality situation. I'm sure that they want to have a say. Sure, there's
Okay.
some kind of stock in that. But I'm sorry, that's my bad, guys. Are we live now? Or are we not?
Yeah, but I gotta fix something. Okay, they see you. I gotta do something. Where's me? Where am I at? Where am I at on the screen? Okay, let me try this again. Darn. Okay, Skype and OBS don't like each other. So now my thing doesn't show my cam. I don't know why. I hate to take out so much time for troubleshooting, but I appreciate you guys for joining. What's up? Let's see if this is Happy Monday. Where's my screen? I don't see. Oh, here it is. Okay. All right. Anyway, so I was asking people, did they buy Call of Duty Black Ops 4? Because I want to talk about their marketing as well. Why is my screen not showing? Let's do this. So you don't play video games?
It's been a few years since I have.
Why is that?
Time management, man. There was a point in time where, because I was in a place financially where I couldn't really, I don't like to use the word I couldn't afford. How can I rephrase that? Where I wasn't in the best position financially to afford the games and to do that. So then I got used to not really having any vices. And since then, it's just been a habitual thing. Like I used to love being, I mean, I used to love video games, bro. I used to love being, on the Xbox and playing 2K. But it just chunked up so much time. And then when I finally did start making money, it was like I got more obsessed with, you know, building this up. But I do understand the need to have some leisure. And I'm kind of getting into like games on my iPad. Like I got into like NBA Live on my iPad. I might get 2K and get the little controller and all that stuff too. But right now I'm just like, it's time management, man. I don't want to say I don't have enough time. It's just like, I don't know. I'm just in a different place than I was. Sometimes I wish I did.
Well, because you started on MTV, what was it? MTV
Music Generator.
Music Generator. So that's why I was kind of alluding to if you still play video games. Well, you're saying that being more effective, you converted that video, wanting to play a video game, into running your business. Is that what you mean?
The business became a video game, honestly. That's if you really want to keep it funky, like the business became, like one of my favorite games coming up on my computer was Roller Coaster Tycoon. Right. And I don't know if anybody, oh, there you go. I can finally see you.
Yeah, I figured out a way. I don't have to close out the apps anymore. Okay, sorry about that.
So my favorite game was Roller Coaster Tycoon, where you basically could design your own roller coasters and your own theme park, but you also were in charge of the budget. And like, I don't know, when I got over my fear of spending money to invest into my business, I looked and I was like, yo, this is the same game, except I'm playing with real money. So I think business became the video game. Hold on just a second.
Yeah.
Did you want to use my phone? Because they have a phone number for them.
I try to tell people the same thing. I'm like, when you start getting into business, real business, and like the fun of it all and the contribution and the growth and all these things, you start to realize it's more fun than playing a video game. Like sometimes I'll be playing Black Ops 4 downstairs. I don't think it's as good as the battle royale of PUBG. I don't like it just feels different. It's like it's first person for one. It's cool. I like playing the multiplayer. I'm still getting into it. That's why I ask people, did they play it? But then I'm sitting there playing it thinking like, I will probably have more fun going upstairs doing stuff. So it doesn't become that high anymore, and you convert that, you know, addiction or whatever to creating value, and that's where it's a lot of fun.
I mean, and we need that as human beings. We need time to play. We need time to be in a place where we can just that word is not decompress, is it? Where you just kind of like.
That sounds right. Sounds like
decompress. It's right. Yeah, decompress. You just like let just time be. And you enjoy this moment as it is. I didn't do enough of that. And I think that's where I'm starting to balance this out. But honestly, my decompressed time is probably spent with family now, more so than a game. Like I can't imagine telling my wife, like, oh, I can't spend time with you and Nas because my player on NBA 2K is almost at 90 rating and I can't, you know what I'm saying? So like, it's just different now, I guess, because of the responsibilities that I have. But I don't know. I think you need it to some degree. Maybe that's what like some of my like I still play what's the name of that game? Damn, it's escaping me right now. Temple Run. I still love Temple Run. I know it's like super old school now, but I love Temple Run. It gets the job done for me.
It gets the job done. It's so funny. it's just like I remember I used to wake up and like immediately get on my Xbox just to play on Xbox Live with people who are already on. Like, it was getting to a terrible point. But all I had to do was just convert that energy into something positive and productive. It's the same feeling. You know, it's the same competition feeling. It's the same learning feeling. It's the same, even better, accomplishment feeling. So if you get, you know, hype over getting your prestige in Call of Duty, you're going to feel hype when you, you know, expand your business. It's just the same exact thing. And it's real life stuff. So you can actually use your rewards versus it being all virtual and digital.
And also too, bro, this is a personal issue for me, but I can't get over, there's a voice in my head that becomes louder and louder the longer that I like have leisure time.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's guilt, I don't know what it is, but it's a voice that's like, Curtis, you could be doing something more valuable with your time. Like, I don't know what that voice is. It's crazy. Like one time I had I feel like it was a very spiritual experience where I was like, I wasn't playing any games. I was just kind of like laying down. And I, you know, that time period in between you finally going to sleep and when you're like, just, you're just up, but the light is on. like that, whatever that like window of time is before you transition to sleep. And I kid you not, I sat there in a quiet room and I heard a voice clear as day said, "Real men don't waste their time." And I stood up and my heart was beating so crazy. And I don't know if I was hallucinating or whatever it was. I think it was a spiritual experience. And I got up and I never felt the same, like playing long extended times of games and whatnot. Especially too, because like I don't know, like I've been setting some, and I'm not want to down anybody, especially nobody like yourself who spend the time to do it. I look up to it. Yeah. I can't get past that voice in my head. That's like, do something else.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a child. I do have a puppy, but he's not here, so he does get a little bit of that time that you're talking about. Also, I'm not where you're at right now. So, but what was I going to say? Oh, one day I heard this. I was in like you said, that kind of voice thing. I used to think people were just like tripping. But one time I was doing something. I forget what it was. And it's like your brain's not thinking of it. Does this make sense? Like your brain's not making the voice. And I heard my mom's voice like say my name like clearly. Ooh. It scared the crap out of me. I don't know if maybe we're tapping into that. Our brain is a transmitter and a receiver as well.
Sure.
So maybe we're receiving people's thoughts and we can hear it almost as if they said it right next to us. I don't know, but whatever it is.
I believe that. I don't think that's far-fetched at all.
It ties into string theory and stuff, but I had that experience too. I was like, whoa, I thought she was in my house. It freaked me out.
I've heard my dad's voice, especially when I walk past a trash can and I see like a little bitty piece of trash and I'm like, I'll come do it later. It's like, pick that up. I'm like, whoa, Pops, where are you at?
Pick that up. It could be, I don't know, it's weird, but you hear it clear as day. That's one thing that's really a mystery for me. How does our brain deal with music? And like, we memorize music and lyrics to the T, like the melody, everything about it, in a sequential form to where we can sing it back and we hear it in our head like it's the record itself. That's magical to me.
That is magic.
More talented than we think. But getting into the Black Ops, the reason I brought up Black Ops is because their marketing is to stay trendy, but offer their perspective. So are you familiar with the Call of Duty series?
Yeah. Yeah, I've played it before. I got my ass whooped on it a few times.
So they got popular because when we went to war under George Bush, Call of Duty came out because our enemies were the Iraq or like the terrorists or whatever.
Yeah.
Over in Afghanistan. So that game resonated with like real world. This is what that war must be like. So that's why the game became so huge. It's because it was a huge thing after 9/11. So they capitalized on that war. Just like war capitalizes on war. So anyway, that's why the franchise became huge. And then the war died out. Modern Warfare 2 was like the real end of the war. Like the time period matched. And then Modern Warfare 3, we weren't really in war, so they were trying to like press the war thing, and it wasn't resonating with the people. And then all the other Black Ops and all those were like retro because they knew there was no real war going on. So it kind of, over time, people complained that Call of Duty was losing its identity. So long story short, what they do to stay relevant is try to use zombie modes, multiplayer modes, and story modes. But now they said, let's really stay relevant and compete with the biggest dog in the game right now, which is PUBG and Fortnite. You know Fortnite?
Mm-hmm. I know Fortnite for sure.
That's two gamers. That's the most innovative new thing for shooter games is the Battle Royale gameplay.
Right.
Those were the first two to actually do it. I forget who was actually first, but Fortnite and PUBG are like, they're different. I forget who's first. Probably Fortnite because they're doing better, I think.
I've heard PUBG. I don't think I've ever seen the actual gameplay. What is PUBG? Is it short for something or is it just PUBG as it is?
Stands for Player Unknown's Battlegrounds or something like
that. Okay.
And my whole point in this, we went over this, you got to be either first or different. That's one.
Yeah.
And secondly, but now Call of Duty is the third one. So the question is how do they differentiate their brand from the other two, which are already established? Because you have Fortnite, which is, so this is almost like a case study. So you've seen Fortnite though, the characters?
I have seen Fortnite, yeah, I have seen that.
They're like cartoony?
Mm-hmm.
So PUBG is like the complete opposite, which is like realistic. So it's super realistic and then super cartoony. So Call of Duty comes in like, okay, we're realistic, but we're hyperbole realism, which is exaggerated realism. So you can sprint, you can slide on the ground, all these futuristic things that you can't really do in real life.
That's probably why they have a wider audience, like a wider scope, like an audience that's not so like I have younger dudes and they have like older dudes who like that flexibility that you have, that kind of cartoonist nature to it. That's dope.
Oh, Fortnite was second, says AT. Yeah, and you can always expand like Halo. Halo could bring in the most crazy ideas because it was cartoony. What do you got?
Well, I got some plant power, man. What you know about that, huh?
Plant power. That what Big Zach, what is it called?
The Big Zach,
The
yeah.
Big Zach. It was like I was eating it and you're eating it and you're saying, it doesn't taste like fake, food. But it's not like, this tastes like a burger. It's like this doesn't taste like
You forget, you saw, you see, you forget that you're eating vegan.
Yeah, you just forget. It's a weird thing to kind of illustrate. But back to this kind of case study. So Call of Duty has to come in. They have to be realistic, but also fight the cartoonism. But they also have to be different than PUBG. So what do? They start listening more to all the things that the audience hated about PUBG. So this is how you take over somebody who was first in the market, or who was different, who whatever position you're looking for. You have to listen to what's the word? Objections of your customers, the stuff that they hate. Okay, so they're not listening enough because people would complain. I know this is like out of your realm, but PUBG people would complain all the time because it would lag, or people would complain about all these little things, but they weren't addressing it. They would just.
Is that kind of the position of Minecraft and why they just like underdeveloped everything? Like it just looks like paper compared to these other games. Like they built something that was a complete opposite of their
True.
competitor.
And the fact that it's so like one of those old games, they can be super creative to expand it infinitely because it's modeling the real world in a cartoony form. People love survivalism. But again, this case study real quick is to say they listen to the hate, they listen to the objections. So now they built a whole game based around the objections of PUBG. So they introduced all the things that they wouldn't do. And that's their marketing strategy coming in against the giant in the game. But it gave new life to the whole Call of Duty series. It gave a completely new life. So this ties into innovation. It ties into what we talked about at the seminar, which is to, know your audience, listen to your audience, cater to your audience. The moment you stop doing that is the moment you stop growing. So just concepts like that. What do you think about, I mean, any parallels in your life? I'm not sure
Well, I
if
mean, I think
you.
you hit it on the head, the fact that anything that's not growing is dying. And I think that if we're going to bring it back to producers, I make certain videos on my channel for a reason because I want to see the producers in my community evolve and continue to evolve. You do the same thing. You challenge them and you ask them questions that maybe they weren't thinking in that space. I forget who the quote is by. Matter of fact, I put it on my Twitter. But basically, I've been reading this Tim Ferriss Tribe of Mentors. And there was two quotes that came up, but one of them I want to share with you right now that I just thought was very important, especially as you're starting to start your marketing campaign, you're starting to change it, recalibrate it. The quote is that a problem well put is half solved, and that was by John Dewey. So literally rephrasing or figuring out how to ask a better question will get you to the ultimate result that you want, especially when it comes to trial and error in marketing. But I think with producers, I'm sorry, what was the initial question one more time? I want to make sure I don't get off too far off path.
I think too, I just wrote notes just to give a better context because I was trying to grab it, but it was so abstract that it kind of went away, and I kind of threw it on you because I was like, "Freak, I lost my thought." But here's what I was trying to say. Okay, so between Call of Duty and PUBG, PUBG's the giant. Call of Duty is trying to get into this new market called Battle Royale and trying to breathe new life into their business. So what did they do? They listened to the objections of PUBG players who were frustrated. What do frustrated people do when their partner doesn't listen in a relationship? They go leave the relationship or cheat or whatever because they're not the frustrations aren't being addressed. So what they did was Call of Duty polarized themselves into magnetism. So they're not trying to attract people. They're trying to get all the people who already have a built-up tension in them to release from that thing. So they're motivated by all the hatred for not answering their all the things they objected about. So now they're flying to that person as the salvation, as the answer to their problems. This is why people say all the time, you should be the person that your partner wants to run to, not the person they want to hide from or something like that. Doesn't justify cheating at all. I don't like if you're cheating, you're cheating. Just claim it. You're a cheater, okay? It doesn't justify anything. But I'm saying, you know, that's how Call of Duty position themselves as a polar opposite of PUBG, and they automatically get all the people. So it's not really them trying to magnetize, it's them doing something somebody else won't, and that automatically creates magnetism. And it gets all the le here's my end point, sorry. It
I'm
gets
sorry.
all the leavers who are going to leave anyway and who are unsatisfied automatically as their audience.
So what I want to ask you is, how does a producer then adapt that marketing technique for their business? What will be the real life example of a producer who's doing the magnetizing?
You're saying how would they apply it to selling beats? Okay, so for example, he's always an example. Cash Money AP. Okay, this is no shade. As he's just probably the one getting the most numbers, I think, or something like that. I don't know who's the top producer. I don't research them all. But so let's say Cash Money AP's YouTube page. I'm just saying his YouTube page. You go on and you read the comments. What do people hate about this? What there's dislikes on it for a reason. Why do people dislike it? Is it what are they saying? So you listen to all the objections. You make one big giant Google Excel sheet full of all the objections that people have for his stuff. Then you introduce all those objections as your solution and become the polar opposite of Cash Money AP. But you have to go through manually and find out what's on people's minds. You're not a mind reader.
And you see what's powerful about that some people may miss out on, is the fact that you've established a strong why for why you're doing what you're doing. By having all of these list of things that people dislike, you're saying in your mind, probably subconsciously, that you are making these type of beats because you want to position yourself as the opposite of competition, or you want to be competition, or you want to be competitive within this market. But, excuse me, by positioning yourself as an opposite of the leader within the tight beats campaign of pushing beat sales. That's beautiful. I think that to me, that's a producer that is not operating underneath the what we call the human centipede route of waiting for another producer to find success and then doing the same exact thing, not realizing that when somebody finds success in any business, there are things that you can learn from it, but you don't go and duplicate the entire blueprint of what they did. You got to ball that blueprint up, take what you need to take from it, ball it up, and then move on to something else. And part of taking from that blueprint is figuring out what didn't work in that blueprint. And game just gave you he literally just gave you the game. He said, look at the objections and then to ask yourself, if the customers are saying, Cash Money AP, I know you popping and whatnot, but I feel like your beats are too simplistic. Well, that means that they're in search for things that are probably more musical. Well, then you position yourself not as a musical trap, position yourself as just being like the traditional hip hop producer that has musical productions, right? There's a reason why I do like a Tone Jones, who's like supremely musically talented, has a way to fit in no matter where music goes. Like the top records on the radio right now probably got about two or three melodic instruments total. This man positioned himself to where you listen to his music, it sounds like fully composed. Like you could tell time went in it. It almost sounds like he's collaborating with six other people, but it's just him. There's a reason why he's at the top of the charts on air, but on a consistent basis, because that's his niche. But he didn't find his niche, saying I need to compete with this person. He found ways to maximize his niche by saying, oh, I already make musical production. Maybe if I go further the direction of where I'm naturally producing and now highlight that, I can position myself as a competitor, but it's not the other way around. So for those of you that are looking for like, okay, people want more elaborate Cash Money AP beats. That doesn't mean that you go make more elaborate Cash Money AP beats. That may mean that you do exactly what you're doing, but focus what you highlight in your marketing campaign on your strengths, on the things that people are griping about. Now you can highlight that. What does Tone Jones say on his website? Over 20 years of musicianship, 100% original music. Like, that's a positioning. He positions himself there, and most producers, especially younger producers, are not competing for that. They're competing for, like, the low-hanging fruit. They want the beats that are, like, the easiest to make, the 15-minute beats, the 20-minute beats. And that's fine if that's your lane, but just realize it's a very clouded lane. It's a very crowded lane. So you better find something that you can do that people are asking you, man, how do you do that? You know what I'm saying? That's your sound. How do you do that? And it's important.
And that's the literal, you know, sound. King Blaze says, I have an opening. I have... Basically saying he's going to be opening a baby clothing shop. And I find that the marketing ideas that I've learned from you guys can also be applied to other businesses. You guys are dropping gems. So shout out to King Blaze doing other business moves. So it shows that this stuff applies. You know, I train models. I train people in the fitness industry converting over to music now. But I train people in all these other industries as a consultant to companies on how to get a greater result. For the same effort you're putting out, how do you get a better result? And I think that's what we can do in any field. So this is what I do at BusyWorksBeats.com. Speaking about the being the opposite of everything else. So for example, people have a lot of objections to university and music school. They're like, firstly, I don't want to spend 4 years in music school. It's a waste of my time. So we say, okay, we have courses called Music Theory in a Day at BusyWorksBeats.com/Music Theory in a Day. I'll teach you music theory in a day, or you could take your time for 30 days. Either way, that's a lot shorter than 4 years trying to learn music theory. We also have tons of courses at BusyWorksBeats.com in the premium section, which are 1,000th of the price about, you know, compared to university. So people complain about university price, going in debt with student loans. Are they going to get a job after they go to university? So we say, okay, we'll make it affordable and give you the same exact information, even better information. We have people writing in with testimonials about how they learn more at BusyWorksBeats.com in a week than they did at years in university. And I laugh because I'm like, I can just imagine their teacher trying to teach FL Studio and music theory and like how to make beats. They probably sound like, you know, like, what's it called? Garage music, like house music, but like from the UK.
Yeah. It's definitely outdated, because that's the one thing I can tell from my friends that are teachers. The school system requires them to have a curriculum to present at the beginning of the year. That's part of their job. They have to present what the curriculum is. They give a syllabus. And so many things would change throughout the year. Imagine if somebody gave a syllabus at the beginning of this year for FL Studio and it completely negated all the changes that happened in 20.3.5, whatever, or negated, you know, the Akai professional collaboration with, you know, with Fire. There's so many things that teacher would have to alter within that particular course that, you know, those are the ones that are kind of discouraged a bit from the universities, because they don't have a control over it. It's constantly changing. So the experience may change from year to year, which is not good for the university, because, you know, they don't have a guarantee of this being more valuable this year than the next year. So when you're here following the games, you're following the Curtis Kings, and you're getting those courses from wherever you're getting them from, you know, just make sure that we are all, you know, evolving with it. But we literally have to, because that's the growth of our business is dependent upon our ability to grow, our ability to change, our ability to adjust with changes that occur. So it's very important that you get yourself in the habit of being uncomfortable. You should be comfortable with being uncomfortable.
It's a requirement at this point.
Yeah, for sure.
All great things happen. Sorry, I'm trying to multitask. Again, my mom doesn't understand. I have like 8 jobs when we go live. I have to manage like 14 different live streams, and then I got to pay attention at the same time. So she swears I have ADD, but I don't think I do. I think I'm just...
Man, well, but shout out to moms for even watching. I mean, that's dope, man. That's super dope.
So you're talking about stepping outside your comfort zone?
But I was just talking about that in business in general. You just got to be comfortable being uncomfortable. Like those, the universities promote a very stagnant or slow moving syllabus that has to be presented at the beginning of the year. But if you present that same, if you presented a syllabus for FL Studio at the beginning of this year and expected it to be accurate the entire, like imagine if you had a syllabus from 2016 for FL Studio and all the changes that have happened since then. And literally, like they're used to having, you're used to having professors and courses that are like, this is what we're covering this year. We've been covering it for the last 3 years. We may alter some things, but we're gonna stick with this. I think that's why you find so much of a, you find so much. I feel like that's why you dominate them so much, the universities, because you're able to have as much flexibility as you want. Nobody's telling you what you can or can't do.
I see what
And
you
the
mean.
fact that, and the fact that your business literally grows off of the fact that you have to be constantly comfortable with being uncomfortable, right? The moment that you get comfortable and you stop trying to look for things to evolve what you're doing, your business starts to decrease, and you don't want that to happen. You're trying to grow it at all possibilities. So I mean, that's the best advice that I can give, especially for producers that are in here trying to figure out what it will look like in the long game. Just be used to, just be comfortable with being uncomfortable. Be comfortable with everlasting change.
By definition, corporations, they have a board of directors. So every decision that they want to make, they have to all agree before it actually happens. And that's what slows down these bigger companies. And that's what makes us more agile and free to do whatever we want. And that's why we have so much friction when companies take forever to make decisions or approve of something because like the market moves so fast. You got to be fast. You can't be like, and you got to make, you just got to try stuff. I mean, you got to be fast and you got to try stuff. And that is a benefit for us because again, we have the people on our side. We're fighting for the people. We're not fighting for some corporation backing or like to make our shareholders happy or anything like that. So
We
it's
are our shareholders.
yeah, the people technically, I guess our audience is the
Audience, yeah.
shareholder. I'm thinking about it that way. I mean, technically, we're the shareholders, but we answer to the people, not
True.
the, whatever corporation. And that's why a lot of YouTubers are struggling because the deals are so sparse. They might tick off one company because they work with a different company. Now they lost their deals over here. Now they have to play the politician game to even stay in business. That's why I don't
And then
even
they,
deal with that stuff, huh?
I'm about to say, and then that's why they fail, because they're forgetting that they're abandoning the very vehicle that got them to where they're at. Like you became visible to these other companies. Good. That means that you're doing something right. That doesn't mean that, oh, these companies want me. Now I have to adjust to what they want. They finally listen to me. No. Like to me, that's not somebody who really wants to be in business. That's somebody who wanted to be visible enough to be recognized by all these companies and literally, you know, and that is a technique. You talk about that, positioning yourself with certain brands so that people see you in a different light. But at some point in time, like there's another tweet that I put up. I was like, I realized that God didn't give me what I thought I wanted when I thought I wanted it because I wasn't dreaming big enough. Straight up. And I look back and I'm like, how many times did I want this deal to go through? How many times did I want this corporation to reach out to me? How many times did I want literally what's, you know, pretty much a handout, and I didn't realize it. You know, I was, it was my pride wasn't making it clear enough. But I realized that getting a deal was not the biggest thing. I should be the one giving out deals. That's not ego talking. That's me stepping into my own power, stepping into my own responsibility. The same way that somebody had to build that company up, I got the same two hands and the same 24 hours. And if I build a team around what I'm doing, I could have something that's bigger than what they have going on. But you talk like that in certain places, they look at that as, you know, you're being cocky and arrogant and you're missing out on opportunities. That's why I keep people like Game close, because we talk like this. He's never made me feel crazy about that. And when he talks like that, I never make him feel crazy about that, because I know it's the God honest truth. I stand by it.
Oh yeah, we have. So all the people who send in your CVs and resumes to info@busyworkspeaks.com, this is a quick little announcement. If you didn't do it, you might as well do it now because I'm going through them once again. So it's a process. There's so many that I have to sit there and like do a lot of research on everybody. So it takes a while. But send your CV and resume to info@busyworksbeats.com because we're trying to expand our team. Firstly, I'm looking for blog contributors who want to basically plug your website by writing blog content at busyworksbeats.com. That's the exchange. You're going to be able to freely plug, even implant your videos onto our blog. So it's basically a new advertisement platform for you. So blog contributors, I'm looking for content creators who want to top on this channel and put in really good work. Just like Curtis King was there in the beginning. We had Mr. Different at one point, Sankus who disappeared. We had Alan T, I can't pronounce his last name, forgive me. We had Oh Boy on our channel. We had Craftmaster. We had, who else was on our channel? Somebody I'm forgetting. And my apologies for forgetting. I think in the mix, was In the Mix on our channel at one point? I don't know. Somebody was on our channel and I'm missing somebody. But they helped build up and get their content out there as well. So for example, when Mr. Different put his content on our channel, he blew up into his own thing. So there's an exchange here. So if you want to be a content creator who wants to contribute, again, I'm looking for people who are doing it, not people who are trying to start and like figure it out, unless you're really good at it. Because I can tell the difference. And I'm sure Curtis King can too.
Hell yes. Hell
Yep.
yes. Don't try to begin your empire off of what I'm doing. You gotta be in motion. That the funny thing about it was that I talked about this at your meeting the second day, that the comedian Chris Rock once said that if you're on the side of a road and your car breaks down and you're sitting inside your car, right? And you're not doing anything about it, like you might be calling AAA or something, nobody's going to help you, right? Nobody's going to just stop their car and come help you. But if you get out the car and you start actually pushing it yourself, what happens? People start pulling over. People start running out the side of the street to come help you push your car because they see you putting in the effort. They see you pushing momentum. They see you, like, there's a reason why this dude's like Young Chambers. Who get on game's radar. You know what I mean? It wasn't because he was thirsty asking for I need you to do this, do this, do this. It was because he was actually putting this stuff into action. He went beyond just saying, "Oh my God, you guys are so inspiring." I'm not gonna ever downplay that. I appreciate the love, but I think 2019 is gonna be all about what's beyond inspiration. I need you to put this into action because if it doesn't actually change your life, I've just entertained you. Right? And I'm no different from you reading like from you reading a bunch of Vlad TV articles. I'm no different. I'm just entertaining you at that point. But if you actually get something that you can put into action and you see results from it, I have done you a good service. So when I look at certain people, man, I realize like immediately if you're trying to start your empire where I'm at, or you already got something going on and you're just looking for a little bit of direction, right? When I do my consultations, 95% of the time, I'm asking questions to them because I'm trying to make them get in a habit of asking better questions so that they won't have to come back for another consultation, right? Because most times my mentors have done me a better service, not answering my questions directly, but making me ask smarter questions to get to that destination, right? So yeah, man, it's really easy to pick up, to go back to your point.
Yeah, and it's about that bubble of awareness, and a man helping himself. What's up, E Nice? Lord Mill says Sweetwater knows how to do business. They basically contacted him after a while and checked up on him. They're super company. I have a cool video coming soon with them. Shout out to Martina who hooked that up. Also, she hooked up the situation with East West as well. So she's a connector, a catalyst type of person. Who hooked me up with the fire? I got the fire from Scott. So thanks to Scott from ImageLine.
Hey, shout out to Scott.
Shout out
Hey.
to Scott.
Hey,
So
shout out.
I didn't make a video about it just yet. Caroline, Janice, Tamara, shout out from Hello Stranger for the Razor stuff. Kevin from Razor. So there's a lot of people behind the scenes. But yeah, again, we're trying to expand our team. Mostly looking for content creators like blog contributors, people who can translate my videos into a sensible blog piece. So I have 2,000 something videos to put in the blog form. So I have to do that. content creators. Okay, so you can leverage this huge platform to get you off the into the next level. Okay, so that's a lot of value for you. Let me
Better,
see. So
y'all
there
better
was
do
a
it.
okay. Matt Black says, "Do you think Boom Bap's outdated?" But before I get to him, King Blaze says, "I could never learn music theory. Just got music theory in a day about a week ago." And he said, "Man, my beats are on level 10 now." So thank you
That's
for
super dumb.
your purchase, firstly, and then your testimonial to let people know. Thank you. So everybody else who has
No,
that object, huh?
that's the first product I ever bought from you, bro.
Music theory in a day.
Before you were my friend, I was one of your customers.
Right. Well, now we're it butted into a great relationship. Okay, I'm trying to go through comments. Yeah, send in your CV. Oh, for people sending in your resume, I'm just gonna give you the reality. I don't care about like which school you went to and all that nonsense. What I'm trying to find out is, one, are you trying to lie to me? And then two, I need to see your work. I need to see your portfolio of stuff you've done already. So if you're a sound designer, don't tell me you can make great sounds. Show me the sounds you created. Show me how they're being used. Show the full thing. Sell me on yourself. If you're a blog contributor, show me the blogs you wrote. There's great people in the emails. And for those who put in, that doesn't mean if you didn't get a response, it doesn't mean I'm not interested. There's so many things in there that I had to get all this other stuff done before I could fully go through the what do you call them? Submissions. So you don't have to keep submitting. If you already submitted, you don't have to keep submitting. Just know that just because you didn't hear anything back just yet doesn't mean I'm not considering you, because there's great people who have great talent who reached out. I just want to make that clear. I don't even know if they watch the live streams, but I'll make that clear. Sue, I just had to say that. I know that was a long
It's
rant.
all
Young Chambers,
good.
what up?
I was gonna
Gascon
say
hopped in. What's up, man?
I was gonna say, I gotta duck out really quick. Gotta tickle, take care of young Nas and
Oh,
go get
true.
him some stuff. I gotta get him some stuff, and then I gotta come back and I gotta get back. Like, I don't want producers in here to get the idea that we're sitting here saying we have it all figured out. The degree of separation between Game, myself, and probably the majority of the audience is the fact that simply we failed more, right? We failed more, and we continue to fail at things that maybe it's not as visible as it once was, but we still fail. There's things that we all fail at. I'm still in a place now where juggling fatherhood, juggling a marriage, both of which I love so much, I'm juggling, trying to find that healthy balance and still be efficient in business. And I've got my business efficiency good, but I got to get my timing down. So now I'm in a place where I have to like grind out a bunch of videos today so that it buys me more time to make music throughout the week. Because Lord knows, I got this complete 12 ultimate. I got some things I got to crack open and make some videos about, but really just to make some music. I got to get back to making music. That is my equilibrium. Like that is my. When I'm making music, everything else flows so much better.
Yeah, it's like creating something. I have to do it. If I feel grumpy during the day, it's probably because I didn't make videos or like contribute to something that day. And shout
Facts.
out. Yeah, and I'm gonna start working on plug-in videos more too. I feel like people actually enjoy seeing how to use these other plugins, because we got so used to using Omnisphere. People are like, okay, what else you got? Omnisphere has 20,000 sounds, but what else you got? So now we're digging into other plugins. So you'll be seeing cool plugins here as well. Trizza, you came in late, my bad, but Trizza was at the Music Producer Mastermind meeting on Saturday, October 13th. He dropped, Atomic Gems there.
Yeah, he did. Shout out to that
Along with Diego Ave, Curtis King was my main partner on that one. So anyway, I'm gonna wrap this live stream up. I'll probably live stream some production stuff maybe, because I haven't live streamed in so long. But the thing is, I blew my one right speaker because my speakers were up too loud, and it fed into the mic, and then it fed back, and it was like a screeching noise. And now my right speaker is like sounds like a square wave, sounds buzzy.
Oh
So
man,
I
that's
ruined
not
that
good.
situation.
So that's not good.
So now I gotta buy some new Genelecs, but whatever. Yeah. So Vapor God. Yeah. All right. So let's end it. We'll come back, but we are exhausted from all that hard work we did for the last 2 weeks.
Shout
I've been in
out,
Paramount like
man.
all day long.
Shout out to
Crazy.
you, man, for throwing an amazing event, bro. And thank you for being a part of my event as well. It's a pleasure to collab. We're figuring out, we're gonna have to turn this into a multi-day thing because there's so much information that I know both of us wanna share. Mm-hmm. My thing is, I found myself having a structure and I went off structure. People will see when they see the videos and whatnot, when those finally drop, like I went off structure because I was so in the moment of seeing the people around. And I was like, man, when I see a light bulb go off, I wanna expand upon that, even if it's not part of the actual itinerary, but there's stuff to be learned. And I'm so glad that we're getting underway because to me, getting in front of these producers and taking this on the road is the next level with this because these are not just producer events. Anybody who comes into these events, whether it's the models that you have invited or even, you know, Walter who handled the camera work, they're in different industries. And they find value in the information. Why? Because not only is this business information for all across the board, this is life advice. This is life information that can literally take you and first separate you from the herd of other people around you in your circle, and then eventually the herd of other people who are competing for, you know, what everybody wants, which is to be able to do this full time and to make a living and make a comfortable living at this, but the tools are being shared. I'm enjoying the fact that we're doing this in collaboration. I feel like both of our stories have so much in common, but it's a pleasure, man. It's an absolute pleasure. It's a pleasure to share in this audience with you too, because you didn't have to share your audience with me to start these NPC conversations, but you did it, you continued it, and I'm very appreciative of you, man.
This one's a little weak because I guess people don't know our strategies, but anyway, coming back. I'm gonna make sure it's popping. What was I gonna say? Oh yeah, we teach success. It's about success. It applies to everything: modeling, fitness, music, whatever. So thanks for watching. This is Music Producer Conversations. I'll try and go live. I'm trying to think of anything that can mess up the live stream. I don't know if the speakers are too crazy. We'll figure it out. Thanks for watching. We'll catch you next week on Monday. All right, guys. Peace out.